أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله حق حمده والصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم سبحانك لا فهم لنا إلا ما فهمتنا إنك أنت الجواد الكريم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي وأفوض أمري إلى الله إن الله بصير بالعباد اللهم صل صلاة كاملة وسلم سلاما تاما على سيدنا محمد الذي تنحل به العقد وتنفرج به الكرب وتقضى به الحوائج وتنال به الرغائب وحسن الخواتم ويستسقى الغمام بوجهه الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه في كل لمحة ونفس بعدد كل معلوم لك اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم إنا نسألك موجبات رحمتك اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا وقلبا خاشعا ولسانا ذاكرا وشاكرا وتوبة نصوحا اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع وقلب لا يخشع ودعاء لا يسمع وعمل لا يرفع ونفس لا تشبع رب يسر ولا تعسر رب تمم بالخير رب زدني علما وفهما والحقنا بالصالحين اللهم اجعلنا من التوابين واجعلنا من المتطهرين واجعلنا من عبادك الصالحين واجعلنا من الذين لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته My respected brothers, very respected sisters who are present here and everybody who is watching over the internet. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill your lives with barakah, with khair and hasanat. Make this evening of yours, inshallah, one of those evenings where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted you, accept your amal al-salihah, accept your good deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your evening, put barakah into our night, inshallah, into our learning. Make this learning a beneficial knowledge for us, inshallah ta'ala. We have been going through the 54 fara'id as enumerated by the great Imam of the Tabi'een, Imam Hassan al-Basri rahmahullah. We've been going through the fara'id and we are on seventh fard. That is, it is fard upon every Muslim to make sure that whatever he eats or drinks, consumes, wears, it must be from halal source, halal food and drinks, halal clothing, halal earning. We went through and explained from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala some of the textual proofs for us to go through, and we did. Now we have brought our argument towards the end of our argument, inshallah ta'ala. It is all the questions of halal earning, halal business, halal income. And since our sharia is a perfect way of life, our deen is a perfect way of life, it regulates every aspect of our life, and the economic aspect of our lives, earning our living, is no exception to this rule. So it is fard upon every Muslim to make sure what they earn, what they bring into their household, what they bring into their families must be 100% halal. Therefore, we went and explained very briefly that this particular concept of tijara, business, transactions, buying and selling, which eventually brings money into your house to feed your family, is studied under Kitabul Buyu' in our sacred texts. If you open up any reputable, reliable textbooks on fiqh, you would find this particular section on the Kitab al-Buyu', buying and selling. What buyings are permissible, what sellings are permissible, what kind of business transactions are permissible, halal in Islam, and what are haram ones. And last week we briefly went through the halal, lawful means of earnings. Just the subheadings I went through and explained to you what Ightinam was, Bay' was, Hiba was, Waratha was, Wasiya was, Hadiya was, Sadaqa, Ibaha, Istiqaq, Ujra, Ihraz, Sarf, Qard, Muzara', etc., etc., etc. Like every other science, this section in Islamic law has its own proper terminology and parlance. And they all mean specific things. So for those people who are interested in learning about Islamic finances, Islamic economic system, so to speak, there are so many texts available. But they should first start with the Kitab al-Buyu' of any of the Islamic books, reference books in fiqh. Reliance of the traveler, basically a Shafi'i text on fiqh, you would find this particular section. You would find in many of the Hanafi texts the same thing. So all you have to do is you go and study. We went through this. Inshallah, my intention today is to go through the opposites today. What are the haram and unlawful means of earnings according to Sharia, according to Islam? And inshallah, I want to concentrate, after going through briefly those definitions, on three diseases that is so prevalent amongst the Muslim community. One is called rishwa, or rushwa sometimes, bribery. And the other one is qimar, gambling, game of chance. And the last one is riba, I want to go through. Because these are the most relevant and pertinent to our daily lives. Bay' batil is a contract that cannot take place. False contract. Buying and selling things in any given society, in any nation, which is for free. Like, you cannot come around and say to me, I'm selling air. What do you reckon? I'm breathing air, it's for free. You can't sell, you can't buy and sell air. Unless you are buying oxygen for a tank to dive in to a particular diving in the sea. You want to submerge, you want to do scuba diving or whatever diving that is. To buy that air is okay. But to come and sell me the air that I'm breathing, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to me, is not allowed. I'm just giving you. There are certain things which are regarded as free, balash, majanan from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, cannot be sold, cannot be bought. Any aqd, any form of transaction in this regard is batil, false. Because they do not mean any possession of anything or possessing any wealth or property. The second form of buying or selling, bay'a fasid, is something that is mashru', never mashru'. For example, a person has sold a kilo of honey for $5. And somebody took this honey from the other person's hand, confiscated. He bought it for $5. He bought the honey in his hand, but he didn't pay the money yet. So he confiscates honey. Give it to me. You don't possess this honey. And he goes and sells it to somebody else. I haven't paid the money to the guy that I bought the honey from in the first place. So this is a circular transaction where this is not permissible. This is no transaction takes place because I haven't actually bought the property for the good from that person yet. The other type of makruh type of bay' is when, in essence, the actual thing that you buy is mashru' according to Sharia, it is permissible. But, however, there is something haram just put into it. It has been contaminated with certain haram. For example, certain prohibitions. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا نودي للصلاة من يوم الجمعة فاسعوا إلى ذكر الله وزروا البيع. Oh, you who believe, when the time of the Jum'ah comes, rush to the Masajid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's fard for every male Muslim to go and attend the Jum'ah and listen to khutbah and pray Salat of Jum'ah, correct? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, stop doing any business. No business. No transaction. For if you have a fish and chip shop just around the corner, Salat time, Jum'ah, just around the corner, if you were to continue to buy and sell during at that time, for example, this is called a makruh. I think according to the Ahnaf, tahrim and makruh, close to haram transaction. So buying and selling in essence is good. Doing a business is okay. But during what time are you doing it? Because of this Jum'ah time, that Jum'ah time prohibition makes that particular transaction also prohibited. This is something that we need to understand. Yes? There is a sheikh who's an expert sitting next to you with the white cap. You ask him. Okay? Now, let's look at rushwa or rishwa. Bribery. Rushwa is one of the common, most common diseases of the third world countries, and Muslims are at number one at this one. They say Nigeria is number one, Pakistan is number two. Indonesia the third, Turkey just follows behind it. Egypt actually tops everything off. This is a disgrace. What does that mean? In Australia, none of us may have perhaps even heard about this. You are, for example, a public servant. You work as an engineer for the RTA. Okay, you're an inspector for the council, for the buildings. They pay you full wages. You went for the interviews and you got the job and it's a really good job. But this is what is halal for you, is the money that you get from your where? Wages. But somebody comes, he says, listen, I've got a house that I want to speed it up a little bit, the permit from the council. And when I'm dealing with you, I put a $500 or $200 in the papers and just pass it on to you. And you see that $500? And says, oh yeah, no problem, into the pocket. Then, your job will be done this afternoon. Everybody's waiting for what they call 2 weeks, 2 months, 3 years. But this person's job is done because of that extra money that person has received from that person. This is called corruption. This is called bribery. That person does not deserve that money. Sometimes, oh, it's only hadiyah. It's only a gift from us to you. That's absolute rubbish. What's the chances of that particular public servant receiving that hadiyah, that gift? If he were to sit at home and do nothing, doesn't work for the council, what's the chance of him getting that 200 extra bucks? This is absolutely haram. So if you were to abuse the position, the status, the job that you're given, and ask for extra money from people, more than what you're supposed to get, this is called rushwa. There are many versions of this rushwa. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ الرَّاشِي وَالْمُرْتَشِي الَّذِي يَمْشِي بَيْنَهُمَا. Simple. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse who? The person who gives bribes, offers this money to corrupt the person, and the one who takes this, who's been corrupted, the corrupt public servant, and the one who facilitates this. Let me make a phone call, you go and see him, put 50 bucks in the thing, it'll be all right, mate. In Australia, we never heard of this until recently. There was no such thing as bribery before. Many of the purchasing officers of the companies, they begin to deal with this bribery. They call gifts. They say, I won't give you this contract until you buy me a new car. Why? Many purchasing officers are very rich people because they can ask for money. The contract is a couple of $1 million. And the man is getting $80,000-$90,000 for his job, which is more than enough for him. And yet he abuses this particular system and asks for money. Amongst the kuffar, regardless what they do, is none of our business. But amongst the Muslims, this is absolutely haram. When you ask for something that you do not deserve, when you ask for or give somebody more than what they deserve, this is called, anything excess above what they deserve is called rushwa. Hadiyah is different. Sometimes people disguise this rushwa as hadiyah, as a gift, and give it to the people. It is not. During the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used to go and collect, some of the officers go and collect the zakat from people. And when people give zakat to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's officer, they also give some money or something hadiyah on top. He cannot take this. Because if he wasn't working for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's that zakat office, what's the chances of him getting that money? Nothing. Corruption amongst the Muslim ummah today is one of the biggest diseases. You can't get anywhere in Egypt, in Indonesia, in Turkey, in Nigeria. We were stopped by a policeman right in the heart of KL, traveling in a car. The driver is a Singaporean citizen, but driving in Malaysia. And the police officer, he said, where's your license? Malaysian license. He said, I don't have a Malaysian license, I have a Singaporean license. Not good enough. You have to come to the police station. He says, I know the law that we are allowed to, we're international drivers, and it is valid, the valid license. He says, you have to come to the police station. I am right in the middle of the road, in the traffic. If I were to deviate, I'd lose at least 4, 5, 6 hours at the place. And my family will be absolutely worried. And I will lose my business transaction that I'm going to go to interview for, to meet the client. I'm going to lose many things. But he says, yeah, what are you going to do about it? The police says, what are you going to do about it? Come to the police station. He says, actually, I don't want to take you to the police station. He says, come on, see me. What does that mean, see me? They put your license or something in it and give it to me. I'll fix it. You fix you and just let you pass. The police officer being corrupt. This is absolutely haram. Clear? Rushwa is something that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, fetches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's la'na, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's curse. A Muslim does not give rushwa, does not receive rushwa. Ulama also tell us, if a person is supposed to do something by right, by his job, and yet he asks for something on top, this is called rushwa. For example, I am a teacher of Quran. I know Quran, I'm teaching Quran. I've been paid by the society and by the hukuma, by the government, and alhamdulillah, not a problem. Somebody comes, he says, please teach my child at the mosque Quran. I say, it'll cost you $20 an hour. This is rushwa. Or somebody says, I am doing my nikah, can you please do nikah for me? Please, 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 I beg you. I come to the mosque and do my nikah. To ask for money for this, which is your job, it is also rushwa. If, for example, you went to the grave, he says, my husband is dead, can you please come and do the burial for us and do some dua? He says, yep, it'll cost you 200 bucks. I charge by the hour. These are all rushwa. In our culture, we have a particular practice that in amongst the Turks, it doesn't get practiced here, alhamdulillah. Some of the young people, when somebody gets married, the wedding car is waiting at the door, and the bride and the groom gets into the car, and everybody stands in front of the car. Unless you give us something, we're not going anywhere, and costing you. What am I going to give you? He says, come on, 100 bucks for me, 200 bucks for him, 100 bucks for him. The money he collected in the wedding, it goes to these people. This is called rushwa. In amongst the Malays, they have this custom too. They hide their shoe, they do something else, they play pranks on the bridegroom and groom and pay money. That's called rushwa. Milder form, maybe innocent form, nonetheless, it is rushwa. We need to be extremely careful. So there is official corruption, but there are certain adat, there are certain customs amongst the people, actually border, if not within the rushwa boundaries. We need to be careful. The next is qimar, gambling. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse 90, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, innama al-khamru wal-maysiru wal-ansab wal-azlam ridsum min amal ash-shaytan, fajtanibuhu la'allakum tuflihun. O you who believe, all intoxicants, everything that makes you drunk, and all gambling, every game of chance, and sacrificing to stones set up and dividing by errors, are only an uncleanliness. Rijs min ash-shaytan. This is the work of shaytan. Shun it. Therefore, keep away from it, so that you may be successful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ijtanibu. The word al-maysir is used as gambling. Maysir is the word that is game of chance. Any and every form of game of chance is regarded as haram. What is game of chance? Two persons are together. He says, let's bet. If I win, I get 10 bucks. If you lose, you get nothing, but you pay me 10 bucks. This 10 bucks is haram. You can, every form of betting, as long as it involves some quick earning some money, this is qimar. Without any hard work, it's qimar. Game of chance, it is called. Tats lotto, 100% haram. What are the other names they use these days with glorified names? It's all haram. Even two children were playing games to one another with billiards. One of those little marbles. He says, you're going to give me 20 cents if I hit that ball? If I hit that marble? Yep, that's qimar. You can't. It is haram and haram and haram. No betting. Amongst the Arabs during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to play many games. But there was one particular which was very famous and used particularly for gambling. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من لعب بالنرد نرد not nerd نرد فقد عصى الله ورسوله نرد is what the people of today call something in between backgammon yep backgammon and chess in between where they throw the dice and whoever comes up moves things like any form blackjack to green jack to purple jack anything and everything of any game of chance is absolutely haram. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says so many even worse things than this. He says he who plays this particular game of chance for money betting this is a person this person has disobeyed Allah and his Rasul. What is our purpose of living in our lives? To obey Allah and His Rasul. For a person to disobey Allah and His Rasul is playing with fire. But the majority of the children of today, they play cards. Playing cards is also haram. If you bet money on it. If you say, okay, if I win, if I get this round, you getting me a kebab from the kebab shop. Is all right with a drink, 600 ml of Coke. Haram. You cannot do this. No betting of any kind. But Eno cards, some other cards, Muslims get together, give me the cards, let's play. We're not actually making any qimar, we're not actually gambling, we're not exchanging any money or betting, but you are playing with the tools of qimar. This instills in your mind, in the hearts of the younger children in particular, it is okay to play with the tools. So later on, if you're jahil, if you did not receive the proper Islamic education, it's okay for you to play for 10 cents, 20 cents, a dollar, $5, $20 for a car, for a house. Qimar is such a disease amongst the Muslims of today. From horses to dogs. From betting on horses to dogs. I know quite a few families that I do counsel with. Subhanallah. The man is 65 years old. Secretly, because he has got this addiction of qimar, takes the money that he earns from the job that he earns and goes and spends it in qimar. In one night, he spends the whole lot and comes back home and makes up excuses for the family. Family is in ruins. They can't pay for the fees of the children, of the schooling. They can't even buy milk sometimes. So they were asking me, what shall we do? A husband, even children don't even know. Husband comes up with a lie each time. And he's a haji. He went to hajj and he prays five times a day. He prays five times a day. He never misses Ramadan. But he's got this disease, sickness. Some play with dogs. They go to the greyhounds. Exactly the same thing. Whatever it is, even if it's dodgem cars, if it's even, what is the other one that everybody races, gets into the car? The kids love it on a small track. Go-karts. If you're doing with a bet on it, it's still haram, still haram, it's still qumar. Simple as this. So no betting in Islam. Or let's say friendly bet. There is no such thing as friendly bet. Bet is a bet is a bet. It's only $2, man. What's $2? It's not the size of the amount, the quantity. It's the act of defiance, the sin that you are committing against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what you have to understand. All forms of qimar is absolutely haram. However, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam allows for us to have competitions without betting. Horse racing, yep,
I've got two horses. I'm on drive. We went to horse racing together. And let's go. Who's going to win? Let's go. Who's going to make it to the other end? This is not gambling because there is no money involved. There is no benefit involved. And this is actually encouraged in our deen. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asks, tells us, an Ibn Umar radiallahu an, لا سبق إلا في خفن. I can't read it because my eyes cannot see. أو حافرين أو نصل. There is no competition except, he says, in horses racing and in riding camels. Why is this so? Because at that time, the person who's better in horse riding and camel riding will be a good soldier in war. For jihad, he needs to know how to ride, how to compete, not a problem. But if there is any form of money involved in this, it is absolutely haram. Qimar. So any income from Tatsloto, some people make a very good intention. Niyats are pure, mashallah. As soon as I get 9 numbers, how many of them? 12? 9 numbers, I'm gonna pay the debt of the mosque. We heard that Coburg Mosque has $165,000 debt, and we're going to pay this off in one go. Halal, halal. You can't turn a haram into halal. This is absolutely not permissible. That haram is always haram because it is qimar. It is a form of chance of gain, game of chance. In a list we had ظلم. What is ظلم in terms of business? And خيانة. When you oppress people, when you subjugate people, when you confiscate other people's property by force, you use your prestige, you use your position, you use your power, you are the bully in the market or in the business, you go and extort things, this is absolutely haram, extortion. Khiyana, betrayal, when you betray somebody and do behind their back, do other contract, double dealing and everything else that you get into business with your business partner or buying, selling with others, this is also haram at the worst possible level. Hayla and khud'a is cheating, trickery of every form. Najash is one of them. Every form, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he who deceives us, he who cheats us is not one of us. You know the property that you're selling to the person is defective. And yet you say, Wallah billah habibi, this is good. Good for ya. Yep, how much? One of the most common businesses among the shifty people of today in Australia is buying dead cars, smashed up new cars. They go and resurrect this car and do new panel beating, new sachet and new something else, but it is a dead car. And the buyer doesn't even know anything about this, so he sells it as if it's a new car. The car is only 2 months old, had a car accident, and it was written off by the insurance company. So somebody Muslim buys it, and he resurrects the car and goes to the auction and sells it. Or sells it in his garage, or sells it on the eBay or newspaper. And doesn't tell the customer, this has been a previously smashed, written off car. The money that he gets from this is haram. Absolutely haram. Because there is trickery, there is deception in this. He says, sign here, this is I'm selling you from the catalog. All the description specs of that particular product is there. Any product. I know one particular company, subhanallah, they called me to the court to give evidence. The guy paid $480,000 to fit out his big, beautiful shop, an Italian fella. And he bought the machinery from this particular Muslim. And the Muslim promised them everything according to the specs. But what he gave him was completely different. He bought it from China. And he changed the insides, the machine. Insides, everything. And it from outside, it looks the same. But inside is 100 times cheaper. Therefore, he made, according to his thinking, $480,000 from here, plus another $200,000 from there, and he has made some money, and he has tricked the kafir. This is absolutely haram. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَيْسَ مِنَّا مَنْ غَشَّ مُسْلِمًا أَوْ ضَرَّهُ أَوْ مَا كَرَهُ. He who is not one of us who deceives a fellow Muslim, who without letting the Muslim know cheats him, cheats his right, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says he is not one of us. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says he is not one of us, what are we going to say? What are we? We're not Muslims. Years ago, back in 1980s, I had a beautiful green car. And I had to sell the car because I need to go to somewhere else. I need the money. I put the car in the trading post. Somebody came looking for the car. He says, oh, I like it. I like the green. Sure. I said, hold on. We have agreed that the selling price is $1,000. Okay. I said, the right-hand side door doesn't work. Uh-huh. I said, there is a crack on the side of the car here. I said, there is something else here. There is something else here. I'm listing all the faults of the car. The guy says, I've never seen anybody like you. Are you trying to sell me the car or trying to change my mind? He says, are you trying to buy the car or sell the car? Because usually if you want to bring the price down a little bit, you try to find faults with the car so that you can negotiate. He says, are you the one who's buying the car or selling the car? I said, I'm selling the car. I said, I am a Muslim. I need to tell you the defects of the car. Because I didn't say to you as is. If I said to you as is a different story. But you're buying a car from me. Then you should not come back to me and say, how come this doesn't work? The carburetor doesn't work and this doesn't work, this doesn't work. I said, this is prohibited in my religion. I'm a Muslim, unlawful to me. The guy was so impressed, he actually gave me $50 extra on our transaction price. He says, I've never seen such a person like you. He says, extra $50 for you. As a, what they call, selling price on top of it. No problem, we shook hands. That's not reshwa, because we haven't sold anything yet. We're still negotiating. He says, how much is your asking price? I said, my asking price is $1,000. He says, here's 100 into what he called 1,050. I'm impressed by you. So a Muslim has to tell the prospective buyer the defect of the goods that you're selling. If not, this money is haram. You bring this money to home. You bring this money to your family, and this is absolutely haram. Another, ghasb is similar meaning when you extort, when you confiscate other people's property. The speaker is hurting my ears. Does it hurt your ears also? Stopped. Start again. Ghasb is when you confiscate somebody's property unlawfully. It is haram. It doesn't belong to you. Sirqa is theft, stealing. And Islamic law is very harsh in this regard. In an Islamic Sharia, your hand will be chopped off in front of the public as a punishment. Why, bro? Islam is so cruel. Not necessarily. If every need of yours is satisfied, You're given food, you're given shelter, you're being given clothing. Alhamdulillah, you're a dignified person and you live amongst honest people. Why do you go and steal? Except it's a disease within you. In the Sharia, if a person is hungry, starving, his children are starving, if that person goes and steals, his arm or hand will not be chopped. Because it's the job of the government to make sure, Islamic Sharia government, to make sure that nobody goes hungry. And you're not sent to Australia for stealing a loaf of bread for the natural term of your life. Like all the convicts who came to Australia from England, they were not actually hard convicts. They were simple people who were hungry and stole a loaf of bread, and they were sent to Australia. Islam doesn't do this dhulum. But stealing of any kind, any form is haram, haram, haram. Many Muslims I have seen, they come to me. Some lady was crying 2 days ago. He says, I know why all this bala. She went through all the problems that she's going through in her life and including her children. He says, it's my husband, it's my husband, it's my husband. I said, what happened? My husband used to work in one particular factory, big company. And it was the practice of everybody in the factory, including my husband, that they take an expensive component or something they can sell it outside, or a tool of some kind. They put in their bag and walk out. There is no security at that time. He says, if you go to our garage is full of beautiful tools, expensive tools, all stolen from the factory. These are all forms of haram. Man, I work in a lolly factory. Is it wrong to take a couple of lollies, a couple of Smarties in my pocket? Haram. Haram is haram. You can't change. It doesn't belong to you. It belongs to the person. That person is actually paying you for your work. Who gave you the right to steal from somebody else? Stealing of any kind is haram. Therefore, the punishment is accordingly given in Sharia, such a harsh punishment. It seems that way, but it is not. Since every need of yours is covered within the Sharia, there is no need for you to go and steal from the supermarket. You have the money in your pocket. Why do you go and have to steal a bottle of peanut butter? Unless you are sick in the head. The camera is watching. People come out with lots of big pockets. What's wrong? You open up, it's still there. And you see the amount of number of Muslims doing this is fascinating. Disgusting. It's haram. But there are many other forms of stealing that the big companies steal. Not only small things that you steal from the supermarket or the petrol station or somebody else. Big companies steal millions of dollars. Muslim or non-Muslim, these are also absolutely haram. I do not want to go through the ahkam of what they call cutting hands and what have you, but inshallah ta'ala, I think you've got the gist of the issue. Nabh and Taghrir is another form of extortion, another form of confiscation, another form of going into a place with force, bullying, and taking over other people's property, and by dhulm, is also haram. What is yours, what is mine. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave me, لا ضرر ولا ضرار في الإسلام. There is no causing of any harm to anybody in Islam. My property is my property. Is Sharia guarantees this. For you to come and take my property is theft. It's haram. It's absolutely not allowed. Ihtikar is hoarding. Hoarding is when you know that in a couple of months' time, there will be a shortage of sugar. Sugar that people use. So you in advance, you buy so much sugar and put it in your depot, in your warehouse. And when the shortage hits the market, Usually the price of sugar is $2 a kilo. You sell it at $20 a kilo because everybody is looking for sugar. And this is not profit. This is ihtikar and this is absolutely haram. Hoarding in order to make exorbitant amount of profits is absolutely haram. Any commodity, any basic commodity that Islam people use it, the Muslim community uses, if you do this, this is haram. The khiyana that we have mentioned before is somebody trusts you something. He says, brother, please, I'm going overseas. Here's my property, my house, and please look after it. And this is my this is my title and everything else. Please, just in case something happens to me, if I come back, inshallah, I'll take it off you. Or somebody leaves you the car before they go to overseas, for example. When you come back, you deny everything. What? You never gave me a car. There's no witness. There's nobody saw. And what house? This is mine. What are you talking about? Get lost. This is khiyana. You betray somebody's trust, and this is one of the signs of a biggest munafiq, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks. So this is not allowed. It is also haram. Kasb al-khabith. What is kasb al-khabith? I am looking at my book. To do some of the haram jobs that Islam shuns and you earn some money from this. For example, what do you call divination or fortune telling. Let me read your horoscope. Give me your fingers, give me your hand, and I'll tell you about your future. $20, put the money there first. That's my job, the gypsy. And a big ball in front of you. Ooh, yeah, I can see a young man. I can see a beautiful woman. Oh, a good job coming up. The money that you earn from this kind of rubbish is absolutely haram also. There's kasb, earning from khabithat, from filth, not allowed. Umar, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, one of his slaves, one of his assistants, slaves, workers in the, he brought a, what do you call, beautiful fresh dates. Well, he ate it and he says, where did you get this from? He says, before Jahiliyyah time, before Islam, during the Jahiliyyah time, I actually read somebody's fortune. And they promised me that they will give me fresh dates, and this is a payment for it. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu put his finger into his throat and took everything out. Many are Muslims today, when somebody gives them something, they don't even ask. Parents, wives do not ask their husbands, where do you earn your money? In the olden days, our grandmothers used to say, when the husbands leave the home to earn some living, you know, to bring the bread home, they used to say, oh husband, we are so weak. We won't be able to stand the fire of Jahannam. But we will be able to stand the pangs of hunger. So whatever you do, bring home only halal. Even if it's some dry, rotting bread, moldy bread, as long as it is halal. But we can never stand the fire of Jahannam. Nowadays, wives, if they are spoiled by the husbands, they want this, they want this, they want this, and husband cannot meet the demands of the husband, the wife, what does she do? What does he do? He goes and resorts to these haram ways of intertransacting. And this is also haram. So coming back to inshallah, Najash is actually a form of cheating, deception. When you're not intending to buy something, but you are trying to increase the price of it by pretending to buy it so that the people, honest buyers are deceived by this. Deception in sale. In auctions, we see this all the time. Somebody bids, false bidding, they call it. Oh, 250, 250, the guy is, too many people are bidding. But actually, their own men, they never buy anything. So this is absolutely haram to do so. Now let us look at riba. I'm going to look at some of my old notes, then inshallah ta'ala perhaps it can speak my mind better in writing. Stocks, bonds, money market accounts, certificates of deposits, variable interest, checking and saving accounts, as well as an overabundance of other financial jargons that have now become a reality in the life of many Muslims. And this particular reality have made earnings and saving our money much more complicated than what it used to be in the past. We need to know, because the game has changed so much. It is so complicated. If you're not aware of what's happening, you will be definitely tainted with haram. And even little bit of haram is something that will ruin your salat, ruin your dua for how long? 40 days. Many of these jargons are in the black spot for Muslims. They do not know. I mean, they are mashallah praying 5 times a day, they do the salat, they read the tilawah, they do the dhikr, but when it comes to business transactions, this is too much of a jargon. They have no idea what the bankers are talking about, what the accountant is talking about. Therefore, they just agree to everything, sign here, sign here, sign here. Then you find yourself in absolute haram called interest. With this ever-increasing deluge of financial options, we Muslims must constantly be on guard to make sure that our money is earned in ways that are absolutely pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is halal, and it is safeguarded from any form of haram. If we become lax and neglectful about how we earn, spend and deal with our finances, we may find ourselves suffering the fate of those who came before us. What do you mean the people who came before us? The other ummats before us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this in the Quran. Surah 11 verse 84 to 85. In the meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O my people, worship Allah. You have no other God but He. And give not short measure or weight. I see you in prosperity, and verily I fear for you the torment of a day of reckoning. And O my people, give full measure and weight in justice, and reduce not the things that are due to the people, and do not commit mischief in the land causing corruption. That was the message of Shu'aib alayhi salam. To his people, he was asking them to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and do their trade in the halal manner, fairly. This specific message was sent to them because of the widespread financial disease that was afflicting this particular nation, and to show that Islam encompasses all aspects of life and is not confined to the ritual acts of worship in the mosque. And guess what their answer was? The people said to Shu'aib alayhi salam back to him, O Shu'aib, does your salah command that you leave off what our fathers used to worship? Or that we leave off doing what we like with our property? Does your deen tell us this? Impossible. What kind of religion is this? There is a separation between religion and the secular life. This is what some Muslims believe today. Business is business, my friend. How about salat? Salat is alhamdulillah. Hajj, alhamdulillah. But business is business. You are mistaken, my friend. There is no difference in obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every aspect of our lives. In everything that we do, from business or no business, there is no demarcation between secular and religious. It's impossible. Although Muslims often inquire about the rules of Sharia concerning the many aspects of the deen and applied themselves to observe them, the financial aspect remains a blind spot for many of us. We are either ignorant of the rules, are not as eager to inquire about them, or worse yet, we feel that these rules do not apply to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent revelations in the Quran that are for all mankind. His rules, His Sharia, reflect His infinite wisdom and are valid at all times, in the past, at present, and in the future, in every place, in every makan. Therefore, one should not be neglectful in applying them under the excuse that he is living in a different era. We live in the 21st century, my friend. Or we live in Darul Harb. We're living in a non-Muslim country. By choice, by the way. One should fear that the wrath, the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ghadab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would befall him as it befell the people of Shu'aib alayhi salam. This article details that I'm going to talk to you, inshallah, the prohibitions of taking, certain prohibitions, taking them lightly and disregarding them by some people. Interest. Oh, we finished, we got back. Interest. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared war against people who deal with interest. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqullah. O you who believe, fear Allah, as He should be feared. Always be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa huwa ma'akum aynama kuntum. He is constantly watching you. He's given you rules and regulations, ahkam, to follow and to avoid. So, ittaqullah, beware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَىٰ إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, give up what remains due to you from riba. This is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that as soon as you become a Muslim, the transactions that you used to deal with in terms of that involved riba must definitely be forgone. Let go, it's haram. No more interest. And if you do not do it, then take a notice of war. Allah is giving you notice that you just declared war against Allah and His Rasul. What will happen to a person who declares war against Allah and His Rasul? Riba is interest, is declaring war against Allah and His Rasul. As simple as this. There are more than 8, 9, 10 ayats in the Quran dealing with riba. There are hundreds of hadith of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam dealing with riba. But this ayah alone is sufficient for us. He who indulges in interest is actually declared war to Allah and His Rasul. Simple as this. This verse is sufficient to show the atrocity of this crime in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone who notices what is happening to individuals and nations can see the extent of harm incurred by dealing in riba. We hear countries going bankrupt. How could this be so? How could a country go bankrupt? They've got everything and yet they go bankrupt. Because IMF, controlled by the Zionist lobby, controlled by the powers, they lend money to the countries like they lend money to individuals. And people cannot pay back, therefore the country is declared bankrupt. They call it banana republic. Their money, their dollar, their flus becomes mafi flus, no money. Absolutely. They control everything through the system called interest in capitalism. Haram. Individual companies, they go bankrupt. So, not only bankrupt, this also causes depression and depression in the family, in the recession in the country, depression within the families, deficit within the failure to pay their debts, along with economic paralysis, raising unemployment and bankruptcy of many countries and many companies. All of this makes the outcome of the sweat of people and their daily hardship pour directly into the payment of the people who offer these interests to people. The people who constantly become rich, they are the ones who make it, and the community still continues to suffer. This in turn contributes to the creation of distinct social classes, accumulating the monies into the hands of a few number of people. This may indeed be one of the types of wars that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned those who deal in riba again. All those who participate in the riba transaction, whether they are the principal parties, the go-betweens, intermediaries, the banks, or the commission agents, or the facilitators, are cursed by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Jabir radiallahu anhu says, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has cursed. He said, the one who takes riba, the one who writes it, and the one who facilitates it, the one who witnesses it, and he said, they are equal in that sin. Therefore, it is not permitted to have a job as an underwriter of riba, or in the accounting or estimating of the interest, nor in its collection or deposition, or in guarding it. In general, it is forbidden to participate in it in any way whatsoever. Full stop, period. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very eager to show the wickedness of this particular disease, this particular vice, by saying, riba has 73 gates. The least of them is like a man who fornicates with his own mother. And verily, the worst of riba is a Muslim's honor. When you defame a Muslim, make iftira upon Muslim, is worse than the riba itself. When you dishonor a Muslim, betray a Muslim, when you call a honest person dishonest, when you defame a person, blaspheme a person, this is also worse than riba. Riba is like fornicating with your mother. Na'udhu billah. Again, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a dirham that a man spends knowing he gained it from riba is worse than 36 instances of zina. One dirham. Because this is a social disease, not an individual disease. It is not only affecting you, it's affecting everybody else, generations to come. The prohibition of riba is general, and it is not specific to the one performed between the wealthy and the poor, as many people believe, but it rather generally in any situation for any person, whether two persons having the same thing, still riba, still riba, still riba. How many rich people that you know, many merchants, many businessmen, have lost their wealth because of riba? To the bank or to whatever liquidators they call it. The least of its evils is that it wipes out the blessing upon the money, the barakah upon the earnings, even if it seems abundant. For Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the outcome of money gained in riba, even if its amount is so big, is always scarcity, is always paucity. The unlawfulness of riba is not confined to what has a high interest, but to any amount of interest, no matter how small it is. The usurer will be resurrected in a state of insanity, as if the shaitan has smacked him. In spite of the atrocity of this crime, Allah accepts repentance from it and informs and explains how to get out of it, saying to those who practice usury, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, wa in tubtum falakum ru'usu amwalikum la yadhlimuna wa la tudlamun. But if you repent, come back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you shall have your capital sums. Deal not in interest, in usury, unjustly, and you shall not be deal not unjustly to people, and you shall not be dealt with unjustly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. This is indeed the best justice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, a Muslim must guard against the crime, this particular crime, and realize its dreadfulness. Even one is obliged to put his money into a bank that uses riba, for fear that it may be lost or stolen if you were to keep it under your bed. He should feel that this is done out of necessity, darura. Ulama have given permission to do so. His case is similar to the one who eats unlawful meat for fear of dying from starvation. Therefore, he should seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be always in search of a lawful substitute for this particular situation that he's in. He should never ask for the interest on the money from the bank. But if the interest is added to his bank account, he should get rid of it by spending it on something lawful, but never expecting any hasanat in return. So if you have money that is coming from the account, say $200 interest, you should not leave this money in the bank, because bank does not deserve your money. It's using your money in the first place. You take the money and give it to somebody else, but not as sadaqah, because you will never get this. Is dirty money, this is filthy money, this is haram money. You cannot get anything out of this. So if you see a Muslim, for example, at the hospital, that he's poor, he cannot buy his medicine, just give the money to him, go. Because at least he's helping him, but you're not getting anything in return. He cannot intend to give it as a sadaqah, but as a way of getting rid of it, because Allah accepts as sadaqah only what is tahir, what is pure, lawfully gained. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to give sadaqah, but from the halal earnings, not from haram. In any case, he is not allowed to spend it or use it in any way for his own profit, such as to buy food, clothes, pay rent, or buy provisions for his wife, children, and parents. Nor can he include it in the zakat due to him, or use it to pay his taxes to the government. Still haram, still haram, still haram. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made an announcement that the first riba that I am going to abolish is the riba due to my uncle Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib. Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib is one of the uncles of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. According to the muhaddithun and mufassirun, I'll give you a little picture of his financial status and you will understand what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. According to the mufassirun, the interest due to Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was exactly 10,000 dinars. People owed him in interest. 10,000 dinars. A dinar is a gold coin. One dinar is 4.4 grams. Get your maths going. 10,000 dinars is equivalent to 44 kilos of gold. In today's value, I looked up today, 1 kilo of gold is approximately kilo bar, 32.15 ounces. With today's rates, $39,274.60.
Only 1 kilo of gold. And he had 44 kilograms. How much will this be? $1.728 million worth of gold. People owed this in interest. He hasn't got it in his hand. People have to pay this money to him, and they will pay to him according to Jahiliyyah principles. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and by the way, if you were to consider the inflation rate for the last 1400 years, can you imagine the money that he used to have? Okay? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam forfeited that particular amount to serve as an example to the ummah of forfeiting and abandoning interest. But I'm going to lose millions of dollars. Rubbish. It's haram. Khalas. Interest is interest. I hear some ugly things amongst Muslims. There was one man who used to come to the masjid. MashaAllah, I used to admire him so much because he used to be here for Fajr before everybody else. And he'll never leave the masjid until Aisha is done. He's one of the local merchants. He makes good money. And his daughter got married. After 2-3 years of marriage, daughter divorced from the husband. And his rich man. And the husband left her, gone overseas. And the daughter is asking for some money from the father. Where else can she ask? And what he did was the most despicable thing I've ever seen in my entire life, as a practicing Muslim, who did not understand the true Islam in his heart. He went to the bank and put so much money into the bank. The money, the interest money that is earned from that particular capital that he put into the bank was about $2,500 a month or 2 weeks, I'm not really sure. This money, he said, you use this money, don't touch the capital. So this is, you earn your, feed your children, one child with from this money. So don't ask any money from me. So each week you go to the bank and get this interest. And that's your payment. Because I can't let you go to Centrelink and ask for money because I am a wealthy person in the community. If people speak about this, and it's going to ruin my reputation. Therefore, you go to the bank and get the interest and feed your children. This is absolutely haram. And he calls himself a Muslim. It's okay in this country, it's all right. Where does it say so? Where does it say so? Haram. Interest. I've got 15 pages here, right here. I prepared on the financial system of Islam. On these concepts that we talked about in a more academic form, because when I speak to the public as in younger people, I need to dilute it down to the level. Otherwise, if you're interested in the Islamic finances, how it works, there are many documents available into our hands, prepared. Many people come and ask about, can I borrow from such and such Islamic bank? But, they say, but, they borrow from a bigger bank and give it to me and they make money on it. Well, isn't that interest? A valid question. I want to buy this house, but what I get from the bank, from the Islamic bank is even more higher. He says, well, do I look stupid to you? I go into the non-Muslim bank and get a cheaper rate. Because I'm paying the same thing, even higher. These are concepts that Muslims are completely confused about. We need to understand. Otherwise, yes, you can make sure that your salat is correct. Your zakat is correct. Your hajj is correct. Your siyam is correct. You follow every fiqh rule. But when you disregard the ahkam of buyu', buying and selling, transacting, earning money into your household, and if it's from the haram source, dubious source, the shak source, you need to know. Otherwise, he who does not know what a danger is, will definitely fall into it. It is equally fard upon us to know, if you are in business,
to know the ahkam of Sharia in relation to buying and selling, in relation to purchasing, in relation to business transactions. As we said earlier last week, Umar radiallahu anh will not allow anybody to come and transact, buy and sell in the markets of Muslims if they are not fully conversed, fully trained in buying and selling according to Islam. Otherwise, people will tell a lie. If you tell a lie and deceive the customer, that's haram. If you swear by Allah's name that falsely, you just say, Wallah, billah, I got this for $2, man. Give me only 50 cents extra. He got it for 10 cents. He's telling the guy that he got it for $2. Why do Allah, we put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a witness? This is also haram. You need to know the ahkam. Gambling of any sort is haram. Stealing of any sort is haram. Bribery of any sort is haram. Haram, haram, haram. We need to make sure that what we earn, what we eat, what we bring home has to be pure. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, fear that day that you will be returned to Allah and every soul will be given complete whatever it has earned and they will not be oppressed. So whatever you bring, go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with, is your own doing. If you earn from haram, you can't blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If your children become asi, if your children become rebellious children, if your children leave Islam and become kafir, because you have something to do with it, because you fed them with haram. Your good intention is not good enough. You need to live that intention. You need to put into practice what you know. You cannot just ignore one part of Islam and practice 99% of it. That will not be Islam. And especially an important aspect of Islam, we need to make sure what goes into our throat has to be halal. What comes into our house has to be halal. Halal luqma. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if you were to have a little morsel of haram food, this, and if it was to become a cell within your body, this cell become deserving of fire of Jahannam on the day of judgment. Simple as this. Islam is very serious about this. Organic living, simple living, pure living, wholesome living is an Islamic motto. You don't have to be a green person, somebody who's a hippie, who goes against the system. No, you need to understand what is halal and what's haram. Inshallah, we will leave it here. If you're interested, I'll put it on the website, inshallah, as a PDF file, so you can download it and you can read it yourself, and you can benefit from that, inshallah ta'ala. Otherwise, next week, we will continue with the discussion of the next discussion, inshallah ta'ala, on luqata, the things that we find on the streets. Is it halal or haram? I found a beautiful wallet the other day. Plenty of money in it. And I went to the guy and gave it to him. He gave me $5. He had over $500-$600 in it. He gave me $5. I said, you keep your $5. Not interested. I did my, honest duty. I could have easily kept the money, like some Muslims think. And I can ignore the license, ignore the number. I said, what? The guy's rich. He looks, he's got so many credit cards. So he must be okay. But a Muslim returned this found money on wallet on the street. There are some rules and regulations regarding this. Inshallah, we will look at this next week. Jazakumullahu khairu jaza. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, wahdaka la sharika lak, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wal asr, innal insana fi khusr, illa alladhina amanu wa amilu ssalihati wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bis sabr. Sadaqallahul azim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, bless us with taqwa, with haya, with ilm, with yaqeen, with proper fiqh, understanding, true understanding of the deen, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala awaken us from our deep ghafla. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to benefit from the knowledge that we acquire. Turn the knowledge, the information that we have into ilman nafi'ah. amalan saliha, inshallah, with sincerity in our hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give success both in this world and hereafter for Muslims, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have rahmah and mercy upon the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and include us amongst the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people who are honest to their word, honest to their belief, honest to their practice, who say, amantu billah, thumma istaqim, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the people who say, I am a Muslim and live purely, like a ruler, straight ruler, do not deviate from the path. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase muhabbat towards one another. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite our hearts, unite our efforts together, inshallah. We will get rid of the interest from our communities, get rid of all forms of haram from our communities. When we have ta'awanu ala al-birri wa taqwa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will unite our hearts and we will overcome all of these problems like we did in the past. Jazakumullahu khairu jaza, lillahi ta'ala al-fatiha.